Audible Studios presents Buy, Hold, and Sell, the investment strategy that could save you from the next market crash. Written by Ken Moraif, performed by Marc Vietor.
Visual aids found in the print edition of this book are available to you as a downloadable PDF. To access this file, please click the link on the product page where you purchased this title. Thank you.
Introduction. One bear market can change your life forever. How would you feel if you lost over 78% of your retirement investments in one bad market? I'd been doing a weekly radio show for 4 years when I was asked to speak at the Managing Your Money conference in Arlington, Texas. After my presentation to some 4,000 attendees, I walked off stage to find a man in his late 50s waiting for me. He said, "Ken, glad to meet you. I listen to your radio show every week." "Thanks," I said, shaking his hand. "Do you know how much money I had before this last bear market?" This was 2002. The tech bubble had recently burst. I was afraid this was going to be a sad story. "No," I said, "how much did you have?" $3 million. "Wow, that's great," I said. "Congratulations. Do you know how much money I have now?" I shook my head, bracing myself. "I have $650,000. I remember looking at the man. I couldn't believe he was standing, let alone smiling. "But tell me," I said, "to go from $3 million to $650,000, you had to see your investments drop to $2.5 million, then $2 million, then $1.5 million. There were signposts along the way. Why didn't you get off the ride?" And he said, "I had every intention. I planned to get out if my investments ever dropped down to $2.5 million. But when they went down that far, I thought to myself, I'm down $500,000. I can't sell now. That'd be ridiculous." I had the feeling I knew where he was going. He continued, "So I drew a line in the sand. If my investments went down to $2 million, I'd sell for sure. But when they sank to that point, I did the same thing. I said to myself, oh no, I'm down $1 million. I can't sell now because the market will come back. I don't want to be the fool who sells at the bottom." He went on. "Everybody was telling me that the market was going to bounce back. I didn't want to miss the rebound." He shook his head. "I never got out. I rode the market all the way to the bottom and lost more than 70% of my money." I wanted to say something encouraging to this poor guy, so I said, "I admire your ability to smile." I meant it. "I could smile or I could cry," he said. "I choose to smile." The inspiration behind this book. I don't want you to end up like that former millionaire. I want you to smile because you're playing with your grandkids, perfecting your golf game, or dancing on the beach with your spouse. I don't want you to have to go through the pain of losing the retirement you've earned. You worked hard and you've looked forward to this time in your life. I want it to be the best time in your life. I want your retirement to be like your second childhood, without parental supervision. And I want to help you get there. I want to convince you of the need to buy, hold, and sell. In today's financial world, you face volatile markets, huge deficits, and even the risks of governments going bankrupt, all of which add up to the possibility of huge losses. With those prospects, I think it's just plain irresponsible to simply ride the market. You need to have a proactive plan that includes a sell strategy. But it's not easy. You've probably heard the same advice the unlucky investor followed. The market will come back. Don't be the fool who sells at the bottom. You don't want to miss the rebound. It's popular advice. If you Google investment advice, you'll probably find information that tells you to hold forever and just diversify. I've worked as a financial advisor since 1988 and have heard these buy-hold myths propagated on the investing public over and over again. Sometimes I've heard them from people like the man in the story, investors who believed in the myths that later destroyed their retirement dreams. In part one of this book, we'll discuss the reasons why buy-hold is a bad idea. In part two, we'll debunk the myths that may keep you from being proactive. In part three, we'll explore the ways to use a sell strategy, and we'll have some fun doing it along the way with the help of a few of my favorite TV characters. By understanding that most buy-hold recommendations are indeed myths, You'll be able to stand your ground when necessary. You'll be able to execute your sell strategy with confidence. You won't be just another placid sheep that blindly follows the rest of the flock right off a cliff. If you're retired or close to retirement, you cannot afford to be a sheep, or, to mix metaphors, to go along for the ride, allowing your investments to chauffeur you around. You have to be in the driver's seat. You have to be proactive and very, very disciplined so that you can avoid the losses that could ruin your retirement. Remember the gentleman in our story. If he had stuck to his guns and said, "Okay, my investments are down to $2.5 million, I'm out," he would have felt the pain of losing $500,000, but I suspect that was nothing compared to the way he felt when 78% of his money disappeared. Protect your well-deserved retirement. Though nothing is certain in the world of finance, you can take action with your investments and help avoid devastating losses. The first step? Keep listening so that you can arm yourself with the knowledge that buy and hold is really just buy and hope, not a viable investment strategy, especially for anyone over 50. Chapter 1. Buy and hold, a bad strategy for anyone over 50. If you're over 50 and still investing the way you did when you were 35, you're in danger. You may be inadvertently putting yourself at risk of losing your hard-earned money, your desired lifestyle, and even your ability to retire. You can't take the risks you did when you were younger. You're not in the game for growth anymore. You're in it to protect your principal. You need to protect it from taxes, from inflation, and from bear markets. When you get within 5 years of retirement, you need to shift your focus to protecting what you have built. It's easier said than done. All of a sudden, you have to adopt a mindset that's 180 degrees from your former strategy. The buy-hold philosophy may have even helped you earn your wealth. It doesn't matter now. That strategy is no longer your friend, even if you're the best investor in the world. Even the best investor. Let's say you are the best investor in the history of the world. Over the past 30 years, you've made 20% every single year. You're a legend. They erected a 20-foot bronze statue of you on Wall Street. Every day, all the brokers and investors who pass by rub your foot for luck. You've amassed a huge estate, a phenomenal amount of money, and plan to retire in 6 months. Everything is great, except that it's now January 2008. And you believe in the buy-hold myth. What happens next? You lose half your money in that 1 year. Even if you end up with a lot of money after the crash, you now have a lifestyle half as nice as the one you were expecting. No matter how much money you have, if you've worked hard to ensure yourself a certain level of comfort, having to cut that dream in half is going to hurt. You now also have the psychological pain of seeing your dreams and aspirations evaporate in front of your eyes. Should you retire after all? Maybe you should delay retirement. At this time in your life, you should not be experiencing this kind of anxiety, stress, or panic. Buying into the buy-hold myth. If buy-hold is such a dangerous strategy, why do people believe it? Because it seemed to work well for so long. Baby boomers, who account for 26% of the total U.S. population, were a large part of the workforce when they were younger. For many years, this 79 million member generation was working in the labor market and building their retirement funds. Did you notice what I said? People were working and building their retirement funds. When you were one of these working and investing people, you lived on the wages from your job while adding to your investment account. Your situation disguised what was really happening. For example, during 1 year, you might have lost 20% of your investments, but since you were working, you also added to your account. At year end, you didn't see a 20% loss reflected in your account. In fact, you may have had the same amount of money you had at the beginning of the year. It would have been easy to think, "I didn't lose any money. Buy hold worked." But you can see that it didn't. You broke even because you added to your investments. When you're still working, you're growing your money. You're putting money in your account. During bad times, you're buying low. You're not as concerned about losses as you will be later in life. Being in the labor force muffles the actual experience of losing money. The buy-hold strategy seems validated when you're working. but its problems are just disguised. When you retire, you'll see the real face of buy hold. You'll be keenly aware of your losses. If you take out 5% for living expenses and then lose 20% of your investments in a bad market, you'll be down 25% at the end of the year. Your wages won't be there to cover your losses. You won't think you broke even. Worse than that, you'll have to change a few things in your life. You can't continue to live the way you did on just 75% of your former income. Look at it this way. Let's say you're still working, and one day your boss comes into your office. Sorry, she says, starting today we have to cut your pay 25%. What would you have to do? You'd have to rearrange your life dramatically to make up for your lost income. You can be young without money, but you can't be old without it. Tennessee Williams, playwright. When you retire, your investments are your income. If you lose large quantities of money in a bear market, and you are living on that money at the same time, your money probably won't last until you're 80. Now maybe you look forward to the day when you can run out of money, move back in with the kids, spend time with your grandchildren, and change diapers at 3 o'clock in the morning. But on the off chance you have different ideas for retirement, you need to protect your money. The buy-hold strategy doesn't safeguard your money. It puts your investments at risk. What do you think the chances are that we will have a bear market between now and the rest of your life? I believe it is practically a certainty that there will be another one, and buy-hold guarantees that you will take a loss when it comes. Chapter 2. 60 is the new 40. What does that mean for your investments? A while back, I was flying home from a financial planning conference, and the man sitting next to me on the plane was reading a newspaper. I could tell something he was reading was really bothering him. Curiosity eventually got the best of me, and I asked, "Excuse me, but what is it that's bothering you so much?" "Well, look what it says here," he said, showing me the paper's headline. "It says life expectancy to reach 120. "So what's wrong with that?" "What's wrong with that?" he said. "Can you imagine your 90-year-old son moving back in with you? Oh my gosh, he still hasn't gotten a job." How long will you live? 120 years old may seem like a stretch, but the fact is that people are living a lot longer today than they ever did before. According to the Social Security Administration, males born in 2007 can expect to live to 75, while women born in the same year will live to 80 on average. In 1900, neither men nor women were expected to live past 50 years old. In a little more than one century, we've gained 25 years or more. It gets more interesting. Most life expectancy charts look at how long you'll live from birth. But there are also statistics on how long you'll live if you're older. In 1950, a 65-year-old was expected to live to be 77 years old. By 2009, it was estimated that a 65-year-old would live to see 84. Think about it. In 1950, the average 65-year-old would live 12 more years. The average 65-year-old today will live nearly 20 years. That's a substantial difference. Remember, these are averages. You could live longer. Life expectancies are determined by averages. For example, researchers look at 1,000 65-year-olds, and when they find the age where 500 are living and 500 are dead, that's the crossover point, the life expectancy. If you're still alive at that age, you're in the 50th percentile. But what if you take especially good care of yourself or have really good genes? You'd likely be in a higher percentile and could live years longer. Over the next few years, it is very likely that scientists and doctors will develop cures for the main killers we face today. It looks more and more like cancer and heart disease will suffer the fate of diseases like polio and tuberculosis. Good riddance. When these advances are made, life expectancy will rise again. It's highly possible that you will live more years in retirement than the number of years you worked to accumulate the money that you will retire on. What does a long life mean for retirement? Living longer means you'll have more time to enjoy retirement, right? More time to play golf, play with the grandkids, just enjoy life. Unless it means you have to delay retirement, to work longer in order to make sure you have enough money to live out those extra years. In 1995, Gallup consultants found that most Americans expected to retire at 60. But now, according to a 2011 Gallup poll, only 28% plan to retire before they're 65. When I was young, I thought that money was the most important thing in life. Now that I am old, I know that it is. Oscar Wilde, writer and poet. There could be a few reasons behind this trend. People born in 1937 or prior to that year could claim full Social Security benefits at age 65. People born after that have to wait until 66 or 67. That might be one reason. The Society of Actuaries reports that people are nervous about inflation's effect on their retirement. That could be another reason. Yet another reason might be that the majority of workers don't receive pensions anymore. Since most companies have shifted from providing defined benefit pension plans to offering defined contribution plans, the average worker is now in charge of investing his retirement money. Will those investments generate enough income for the number of years that people are now expected to live? All of those concerns certainly contribute to the delayed retirement phenomena, but I don't think any of them are the main reason behind the shift. The 2011 Gallup poll found that for the first time ever, more Americans were afraid of outliving their savings than were comfortable with their ability to retire. More than half of workers between the ages of 50 and 64 feared that they wouldn't be able to maintain their current standard of living once they retired. They may be right to be scared. In October 2008, the Congressional Budget Office reported that Americans had lost roughly $2 trillion in retirement savings over 15 months. I think that's probably the biggest reason behind Americans' fear of running out of money. They lost their shirts in 2008. Losing half your money in just 1 year will make you very nervous about the future. The longevity, retirement, investment equation. I want to help you avoid the pitfalls that claimed those retirement dollars in 2008. I want you to live long and prosper. In order to do that, I think it's important you understand the longevity, retirement, investment equation. Live long and prosper. Mr. Spock, First Officer, USS Enterprise. If you retired back in 1950 at the age of 65, you could expect to live another 12 years. If you were only going to live 12 years, you wouldn't worry so much about taxes, inflation, and bear markets. Sure, you wouldn't want to experience them, but at the same time, you could pretty much put all of your money in a box in the backyard, take out what you need to live on every month, and it would most likely last 12 years. But in today's world, you've got to make your money last for 19 years or more. You do have to worry about inflation, taxes, and bear markets. And you have to recognize that longevity is one of the biggest enemies to your financial well-being. If you live a long time, your money has to last a lot longer. If you live into your 90s, the more heavy lifting your investments need to do to support your lifestyle, you're asking a lot more from your money. The longer you live, the more likely you are to have health care costs, too. It doesn't matter how well you take care of yourself, it's just the price of longevity. In fact, the Center for Retirement Research at Boston College found that people who are healthy and live a long life spend more on healthcare than unhealthy people who die younger. Maintenance is more costly than junking the car. Medicare does cover most issues, but not all. What if you need long-term care? Long-term care is not medical care. It is help with the activities of daily living, the everyday tasks that are just a part of life. Bathing yourself, driving yourself around, feeding yourself. These are the kinds of things that are considered activities of daily living. And though you may need assistance with those tasks, you don't need a doctor, so your medical insurance typically won't pay for the help you need. Neither will Medicare. It's even noted on Medicare.gov. Medicare generally doesn't pay for long-term care. Depending on the need and duration of care, expenses can be enormous. Up to $90,000 per year for dementia care in a skilled nursing facility, private room. And long-term care costs are rising. A recent MetLife Mature Market Institute survey found that long-term care provider costs rose far faster than the rate of inflation. Imagine having to spend an additional $7,500 per month on healthcare on top of your normal expenses. Then imagine that the market goes down at the same time. You could be in a very dangerous situation. You could run out of money very quickly. How likely is this scenario? Over half of us will require some sort of long-term care during our lives, whether we need support for a few weeks after a surgery or years of care due to a serious illness. Add to that the possibility of a bear market. I believe there is a 100% chance of a future bear market. But since I can't predict the future, we'll say there's a 90% chance. In the average bear market, the Dow goes down about 37%. In this very likely scenario, there's a 90% chance of a bear market with an average loss of 37% in your future. That's bad enough, but you may see more than one bear market. Over the past 100 years, we've had 33 bear markets. On average, that's one every 3 years. Let's go back to you. If you had parents who lived into their 90s, or you eat well, or you take good care of yourself, you may live 30 years in your retirement. You could have 10 more bear markets in your life. Do the math. If you're taking money out of your investments while living through 10 bear markets, how long do you think your money is going to last? But let's say you live a long time and are lucky. You stay active and healthy. You retire with over $1 million in investments. The economy is great, the market is strong, and you don't have to live through 10 bear markets to experience hardship. It could take only one. If you lose a third of your money in that one bad market, it can change your life forever. And that's just what happened to one unwary couple. Chapter 3. The Bear and the Lake House. Several years ago, a couple came into my firm to take advantage of the free consultation we offer. They sat down with us and explained their financial situation. They were retired, had $866,000 in investments, and were drawing $60,000 a year from those investments to cover their cost of living. "Wait a minute," we said. "You're taking out $60,000 a year? That's 7.5%. That's very, very high. Your investments cannot support that. It won't be very long before you run out of money." "Yes, but here's what you don't understand," said the husband. "We retired in 2007 with $1.5 million. At that time, $60,000 was 4% of our investments, and we could handle it. The problem is that 2008 came along, and we lost nearly half our investments. Now we have $866,000, and even though the market went down, our expenses didn't, so we're spending the same amount." Thinking they were all set for retirement, this couple had sold their existing home and bought a beautiful $750,000 lakefront home. They put the $300,000 they received from the sale of their house into the new house and wound up with a $450,000 mortgage. Every month, they had a $2,700 mortgage payment. "We know you're not clients yet," we said, "but after analysis, we have to tell you that you can't afford that house. You're going to have to sell it. You can take the equity you have in the house and buy a new house. Your house will be paid for. That will reduce your expenses by $2,700, and then you should be okay." "But this is where the family congregates," said the wife. "The kids and the grandkids come all year round. They come for Christmas, for Thanksgiving, for birthdays. It's become the family home." "We understand, but you can't afford it anymore. You've got two choices. You can sell this house, buy a new one, and afford to eat steak, or you can stay in this house and eat beanie weenies." The wife thought about it for a moment. With tears in her eyes, she said, "For now, we'll eat beanie weenies." They finally did put their lake house up for sale. They got to the point where they could no longer afford to stay in it. Unfortunately, by then, it was 2009. Prices had fallen so low that they were going to have to sell it at a huge loss. Not only that, but the prospects of selling the house were bleak. A severe drought had caused the lake to recede 150 feet. They no longer had lakefront property.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.